Okay, good morning to all of you. So let me start with my today's lecture. But before we start, let me remind you what we discussed yesterday. And basically what we discussed yesterday is how solar cell or how a PN junction diode can be used as a solar cell, what happens when light falls on a PN junction diode. And we have seen that how junction helps in getting the voltage positive, current negative, right. So whenever in a semiconductor device, if voltage is positive, current is negative, or in a product the power is negative, then the device acts as a power generating device, otherwise power is consumed. So that is what we have seen. And with the schematic diagram, I have showed you that there are some drift diffusion of current and holes, minority majority carriers, that keeps on happening. But additional to that, what happens under the light generated carrier is the collection of the positive charges on P side, negative charges on N side, that is physical separation of positive and negative charge, which means photovoltage is generated, and this generation of photovoltage across PN junction due to light is called photovoltaic effect. And we also discussed the parameters of solar cell, right. So we have discussed the PN junction, we have discussed open circuit voltage, short circuit current, fill factor, efficiency, maximum power point. Two parameters we have not discussed is about series resistance and the shunt resistance, that we will discuss in this lecture. Okay, so I hope that everything is going fine. Fine. So this is what we have discussed yesterday: operation of a PN junction solar cell, a generation of photovoltage, light generated current and reverse direction, parameters of solar cell, VOC, ISC, fill factor, efficiency. What we will discuss today is, so now we are going to look at the details of the operation of a solar cell. We have looked at it yesterday from the physics point of view. Now we will look at from the device perspective. Now how the solar cell should be made or designed in order to get the highest possible efficiency. So before going further, so today's two lectures are focused on the design of solar cell mainly. Before we go further, what we will look at it, what are the upper limits of solar cell parameter, right. So, the solar cell parameter is VOC, ISC, FF, efficiency. So, what is the upper limit? How much is the maximum value of current that you can get? What is the maximum value of open circuit voltage that you can get? What is the maximum value of fill factor that you can get? And what is the maximum efficiency that you can get? So, these are the various questions you have been asking, and today is the day to get the answer to all this question. So, pay your full attention. How to design a solar cell in order to get a highest short circuit current, and the next lecture I will say how to design a solar cell in order to get the highest open circuit voltage also. Okay. So this is just to recap that this is what we discussed, P side get positive, N side get negative, not all the carriers which are generated due to the light get absorbed or contributes to the current. Some of the carriers get recombined also, okay. Some of the carriers get recombined. So therefore, the diffusion length for electrons in the P side and diffusion length for holes in N side, minority carrier diffusion lengths are important, fine. And then we also looked at the various parameters ISC, VOC, VM, IM, PM, etcetera. Here ISC, I also told you if you are using JSC, the current density, then you should multiply by the area also. And what is the PIN? PIN is a power density of the solar radiation under the standard test condition, that is 1000 watt per meter square, air mass 1.5 g spectrum. Okay. So normally a solar cell should perform following jobs, right. A solar cell should convert light, falling light on a solar cell into electricity as much as possible, right. That is the job of the solar cell that we want. So we want high efficiency. So it should actually absorb the light falling on a solar cell, okay. It should actually absorb the light, all the light falling on a solar cell. What does it mean? It should reflect less light and it should transmit also less light. And therefore, the once the light is absorbed, there has to be, so let me go back to the whiteboard and tell you what are the main functions that a solar cell should perform. Okay, functions of solar cell. Okay, first thing it should do is it should absorb as much light as possible. Absorption of, when the light is absorbed, what you should do? Absorb, and what it should do? It should create electron hole pairs. This is the first thing, okay. Second thing, once electron hole pairs are created, what it should do? See, if I draw my solar cell PN junction, a light is falling, electron is generated and hole is generated, right. We do not want this to be recombined. If it is recombining, then we are not getting help in the current generation. What we want this electron to go to the other side, okay. So, once this electron goes to the other side down the energy, it cannot come back, right, it cannot come back. It goes to the other side, it cannot come back because it has to increase in its energy. And this motion, this hole cannot go here, this electron cannot go here. So, once a minority carrier crosses the junction, we call it as a separation of carriers. Okay, what is called separation of carriers? So, separation of carriers are important. If carriers are not separated, what will happen? They will recombine. Okay. So, second job a solar cell must do is a separation of carriers. Which carriers? Generated carriers, light generated carriers. So, light generated carriers should get separated. Is that enough? That is not enough. What is the next thing? Finally, we want this current to flow in the external circuit. So, therefore, what we will be doing? We should be able to making contacts. Okay. So, we should make a contact. Contact with this side, contact with this side, and we should connect it to the external. Okay. This carrier electron then actually should go and flow in this contact. And this is called the collection of carriers. Collection of carriers. Okay. Absorption, separation and collection. These are the three functions any solar cell must perform, be it amorphous silicon, cadmium telluride, CIGS, gallium arsenide, organic solar cell, thin film solar cell, any type of solar cell, these three functions must be performed. Okay. And these three functions are happening in series. Okay. First, absorption takes place, second, charge separation takes place and third, collection takes place. Okay. So, out of these three, if any one is not performed well by a solar cell, then your efficiency of solar cell will be low. Okay. All these three functions, absorption, separation, collection, must be performed as efficiently as possible. So, these are the functions of solar cell. Okay. This we must remember. So, this is what a solar cell do. Now, we want light to get into the solar cell as much as possible. And sorry, I could not bring the solar cell, I will bring it after this lecture. So, light must go inside the solar cell as much as possible. Therefore, my front metal contact is not continuous, my front metal contact is in this way. So, there are fingers, there are thin metal lines and there is a collection. So, by the way, when light falls on a solar cell, when light falls on a solar cell, this is my p-n junction, this is a solar cell basically, right. So, I have n and p. When light falls, current is generated everywhere, current is generated everywhere. Okay. So, current is generated wherever light falls. So, therefore, you should, your contact should be almost everywhere, but because we want light to come in, so you make selected contact. Okay. So, that your light should come from here, otherwise, and you know this is the metal contact I am showing you, and the metal contact blocks the light. Okay. So, therefore, front metal contact cannot be continuous contact. Okay, cannot be continuous contact, it is in the form of fingers. The back side, if the light is coming from this side, this is called the front side, the side from where light is entering, and the other side is called the rear side. The light, the surface from where light is entering called the front side, the surface from light, so the back side you can have a continuous metal contact. Okay. This H line is a metal contact and this is also metal contact. So, back side can be a continuous metal contact. And the front side cannot be, because you want light to get into. Okay. So, this is what a typical solar cell looks like. So, there are fingers on the front side, there is a metal contact on the back side, there is a p-n junction. Okay. P-n junction is very thin. I will tell you why, we will discuss in the design why the structure is like this, but it has to actually reflect less light. So, therefore, there is an anti-reflection coating that we do. There is also anti-reflection texturing. We make surface rough also, so that reflection is minimum from the front surface. And these thin lines are called fingers, and there is a thick metal lines which collects the current from all these metals called bus bar, and then you have the rear contact. Okay. These are the terminology. the P side is normally called base and N is emitter. So, PN junction is base and emitter. Okay. So, now let us look at what is the highest efficiency we can get. Now, efficiency of the solar cell is a function of VOC, ISC and fill factor, and therefore, highest efficiency means high value of VOC, high value of ISC and high value of fill factor, right. So, highest value of efficiency means how the value of parameters, how much is the highest value of parameters, how much is the highest value of open circuit voltage, how much is the highest value of short circuit current, how much is the highest value of fill factor. Ideally, what is the upper limit? Now, upper limit of ISC, short circuit current. Now, upper limit of short circuit current, what is happening in a solar cell? A light is coming, a photon is falling on a solar cell. Okay. A photon is, see if I look at the solar cell like this, a photon is falling, having energy h nu, it gives one electron hole pairs. Okay. This electron hole pair gets separated, and if everything goes well, there is no recombination taking place, everything goes well, for one photon, one electron will come out. For one photon, one electron will come out. So, this is what is happening, right? And hole will go this way. So, for one photon, one electron is coming, right? And the rate of flow of electron is current. So, once we want to find out what is the highest value of current, what we should know how many number of photons are there in my spectrum. And we would like to find out highest value of current under standard test condition. Okay, under standard test condition, the value, the power density is 1000 watt per meter square, okay, but 1000 watt per meter square of not any photons, it is of the air mass 1.5 spectrum, 1.5 g, g for the global, right. So, this is in this spectrum, air mass 1.5 g of having intensity 1000 watt per meter square, how many photons are there? That will determine what is the upper limit of the short circuit current. Remember, one photon is giving one electron. So, if you know how many photons are there, we know how many electrons are generated and collected. And once we know how many electrons are generated, we can find out the limit for the current. Okay. So, that is why it is important to know the number of photons or the photon flux, how many photons are coming per unit area, per unit time on the solar cell. And this is my spectrum. Okay. And actually, what I have plotted here, there is the photon flux. Yeah. Right. So, actually, if you can see here, this axis is a photon flux axis. Okay. Unfortunately, numbers are not visible, but you can see that the photon flux in the range of 10 to the power 18, 10 to the power 19, 17, number of photons per unit area, per unit time. Okay. So, that is what is the photon flux is there. And if you assume that each photon, okay, here it is clear, here you get the wattage per meter square per nanometer. Why per nanometer? Because this scale is a wavelength scale. Okay. So, this is the irradiation density, this is watt per meter square per nanometer. Now, if you know that this many watts are coming, so for example, at this 500 wavelength, if your radiation is coming at 1500 watt per meter square, 1500 watt per meter square. How many numbers of photons are coming? Okay. How you will get that? So, total energy is, you know, total energy. If you divide by the energy of one photon, you will find that total number of photons coming in that. In that way, you will find out the total photon flux. Okay, number of photons per unit area per unit time. So, divide the energy in a given spectrum width, and this spectrum is very easily available. If you go to the NASA site, the spectrum will be available. The spectrum will give you, okay, from 400 to 410 nanometer, the energy falling is so and so, and therefore, if you divide the energy of the 410 nanometer photon, which you can find out the how many photons are then in that spectrum. Okay, now, if you assume that each photon is giving me one electron in the external circuit, okay, that is the highest limit, right? I know that each photon will not give you one electron. Why not? Some photon will get absorbed away from the diffusion length, and therefore, they will recombine, right. And therefore, some of the photon energy will be lost because of the recombination. Some of the photons will get reflected also, right. So, whatever photons are coming, some photons will get reflected because reflection will not be 0. Some will get transmitted, okay. Transmission will not be 0, and some will recombine. Okay. some of the electron hole pair will recombine. So, electrons in hole recombine. So, this is the loss due to reflection, this is the loss due to recombination, this is the loss due to transmission. So, not every photon in reality will actually result in one electron, but the highest limit will be achieved when every photon gives me one electron. So, this is the graph, every photon gives me one electron. Okay. Now, look at the interesting aspect of this graph is that, and I will zoom it to show you a little bit clear. What is the interesting aspect of this graph? As the band gap increasing, the short circuit current is decreasing. Why it is so? As the band gap increasing, the upper limit of short circuit current is decreasing. So, the short circuit current, the maximum short circuit current that you can get from your solar cell depends on the band gap. And answer is very simple. If the band gap is higher, okay, if the band gap is this much, let us say band gap is 2 electron volt, and if a light falling is 2.5 electron volt, it will get absorbed. But if light falling is 1.5 electron volt, it will not get absorbed. If the light falling is 1.2 electron volt, it will not get absorbed. Okay. So, because when you increase the band gap, there are less number of photon which can cross that energy level and more number of photon will pass. So, this photon, this 1.5 electron volt photon just will pass, it will be transparent. And therefore, as you increase the band gap, less and less number of photons get absorbed and your short circuit current decreases. Okay. Okay, then somebody will say that in our spectrum, in solar spectrum, we have the photons in our spectrum. Okay, we have photons from as high as 3.5 electron volt and as low as 0.3 electron volt. So, why not to take a semiconductor which is 0.3 electron volt, so that each and every photon gets absorbed in a solar cell, each and every photon get absorbed in a solar cell, and what will happen? Your current will also be very high. Is this a good idea? Take a very low band gap solar cell or semiconductor, so that each and every photon will get absorbed, so that your current is higher. But remember, what is our efficiency? It is not only current, it is also voltage, and therefore, we will come back to that. But learn this from this slide that lower is the band gap of the material, higher is the current that you can get. Very nice. So, that is upper limit of current you can calculate. You will find that for a material of 1.12 electron volt, for silicon which is having a band gap of 1.12 electron volt, the upper limit maximum value of ISC or actually JSC current density is about 46 milliampere per centimeter square. Never in the world you will achieve the current density higher than 46 milliampere per centimeter square for silicon. Okay, that is the highest. Whatever you do, you can only get maximum 46 milliampere per centimeter square. Fine. So, that is upper limit for silicon, and you can actually find out upper limit for any other band gap material also. What about the upper limit for the open circuit voltage? What about the upper limit for the open circuit voltage? Look at this band diagram. Okay. The open circuit voltage is actually the, so the first of all the whenever you divide the potential energy by Q, you get voltage, right? So, when you divide the potential energy by Q, you get the voltage, right? I told you all. So, potential energy is Q, Q into V. So, voltage is actually your potential energy into divided by Q. So, if I have a semiconductor which is having a band gap of Eg, the maximum potential difference from this level to this level is Eg by Q. And therefore, the maximum possible voltage, if at all, it can be band gap divided by the Q, that is the unit of voltage. Okay, so, if it is silicon, my silicon is having band gap of 1.12 electron volt. So, 1.12 divided by Q, 1.12 electron volt, 1.12 electron volt divided by 1 electron, that is Q, the charge of the, you get actually 1.12 volt. So, that is the maximum possible voltage that you can get. Okay. But in practice, even that is not achievable, right. So, Eg by Q should be the highest limit of VOC, higher band gap means higher value of VOC. Okay. You are getting some hint, when your material band gap is higher, you are getting higher voltage, because that is the energy that you separate your electron. Okay, if your band gap is higher, you are shifting it to higher energy level, and therefore you can get more work done by the electron. And this, in practice, the possible voltage that you can get is actually from the two difference of the two Fermi level, P side and N side, and basically quasi Fermi level. Under the operation of a solar cell, the difference between the two Fermi level, E F N, Fermi level at the N side, Fermi level at the P side, divided by Q. Okay, what is E? Capital E is a symbol of potential energy. Okay, so potential energy of the Fermi level at the N side minus potential energy of the Fermi level P side divided by Q. That is the highest value of VOC that you can achieve, but the upper limit is band gap divided by Q. That is nothing but the band gap in terms of voltage. Okay. If you look at this expression, the open circuit voltage we have seen yesterday is a function of IL divided by I0, light generated current, and I0 plus 1. Okay. IL is the light generated current, and light generated current depends on what? Intensity of the light, depends on the band gap, right. So, first of all, your open circuit voltage is a function of current itself. Keep this point. Your open circuit voltage is a function of current itself, right. Light generated current will be higher, so open circuit voltage will be also higher in practice, right. But open circuit voltage increases as a log of a light generated current, as a log function of a light generated current. Okay. So, 10 times increase in the light generated current will actually double the open circuit voltage. So, though the open circuit voltage is a function of light generated current, it is not a linear function, it is a log function. Look at here, what is there in numerator? I0, okay. What is I0? Reverse saturation current. Remember, reverse saturation current that we discussed, and I0 is a function of many parameters, okay. Diffusion coefficient, diffusion length, doping level of acceptor. Intrinsic carrier concentration. Intrinsic carrier concentration is function of temperature, diffusion coefficient. You can correlate with the lifetime and diffusion length. Diffusion coefficient you can also correlate with the mobility. Diffusion length you can correlate with the lifetime. So I0 is a function of many parameters. Okay, and look, I0 also depends on Ni. Ni depends on what? Intrinsic carrier concentration. I told you. Intrinsic carrier concentration also depends on the band gap. If I have one material like this and I have another material like this, this is having smaller band gap, this is having larger band gap. What will happen to Ni in this case? In this case, Ni will be higher than Ni in this case. Why? Because of the lower band gap, more electron will get excited because of the thermal energy. In this case, because of the higher band gap, less electron will get excited. So, Ni in the lower band gap material is higher as compared to the higher band gap material. So therefore, and if your I0 is higher, what is your low? VOC is lower. Very important. Okay, if your I0 is higher, reverse saturation current is higher, your VOC is higher. So I0 depends on what? Ni. Ni depends on what? Temperature. So if your temperature is higher, Ni is higher. Ni is higher, I0 is lower. Let me put on the paper here. So your VOC is KT by Q log of IL. Divided by I0 plus 1. Okay. Light IL is a light generated current. So, first of all, VOC is a function of IL. Okay, more light. Okay, more light means more IL, more IL means more VOC. And that you see that when you are actually using solar module, in the morning intensity is lower, so light current is lower, so your voltage will be little lower. In the afternoon time, when your current is higher, because your light is higher, your current is higher, and when your current is higher, your open circuit voltage is higher. Okay. So, if light intensity is higher, then your IL is higher. When your IL is higher, your VOC is higher, but this VOC is a function of log function. Okay. Remember, then this is a very important. The next parameter depends on I0. Okay. So, your VOC is function of I0. I0 is the reverse saturation current, and I0 is function of many parameters. Okay. Function of Ni, function of mobility, function of tau, function of D, function of Na, function of Nd, everything. your Ni is a function of band gap. Okay, so it becomes a function of band gap also. So what will happen if, especially look at the temperature, and many people have been asking what happens at the temperature. So as the temperature increases, Ni, that is intrinsic carrier concentration, will increase because more and more electrons will get thermal energy to get excited from valence band to conduction band. So as the temperature increases, Ni increases. As the Ni increases, I 0 increases. As the I 0 increases, what will happen? As the I 0 increases, what will happen? V O C decreases. Open circuit voltage will decrease. Okay. Fine. So this is important discussion, and that will be useful. So the more important thing is Ni is also a function of band gap. Higher band gap, higher band gap. Okay. So if I look in terms of band gap, higher is the band gap, Ni is the lower. Lower is the Ni, I 0 is lower. I 0 is lower means open circuit voltage is higher. So contradiction. I want higher efficiency, so I want higher short circuit current, I want higher open circuit voltage, I want higher fill factor. What is the contradiction? If I have lower band gap, okay, what is the contradiction? So high efficiency means VOC should be high, ISC should be high, fill factor should be high. That is the meaning of high efficiency. High efficiency, especially if I look at the function of, okay. So when I look at the band gap, when the band gap increases, what happens? Okay, the lower band gap means higher short circuit current that we have seen, right? Lower band gap. I'll go take you to the back to the slide. Lower band gap here means higher short circuit current. But from here, lower band gap means lower open circuit voltage, right? Lower band gap means lower open circuit voltage. So if my band gap increases, my open circuit voltage increases, but my short circuit current decreases. So this is a contradiction with the choice of the material. So there is a contradiction. What I want? I want high efficiency means I want high VOC, I want high ISC, I want high fill factor. But the open circuit voltage is higher for the higher band gap material, and short circuit current, open circuit voltage is higher for the high band gap material, but short circuit current is lower for the high band gap material, and therefore optimum value of Eg is required. Optimum value of band gap should not be very high, it should not be very low. So you have to find the optimum for which your efficiency is maximum. You have to find the optimum for which your efficiency is maximum. And I will come back to this again. Everybody got this? There has to be an optimum band gap value. It cannot be very high, it cannot be very low. Fine. So upper limit of open circuit voltage depends on the band gap, but for all practical operation, the upper limit of open circuit depends on I 0. Okay. IL value, VOC depends on IL and I 0. IL value cannot change significantly, but I 0 value can change significantly, orders of magnitude. Okay. Your I 0 can easily change 1000 times, 500 times, 10,000 times, depending on the parameters of your material, depending on the processing, right. And in brief, I 0 can be given as a empirical formula, as a function of band gap like this, considering the best value. Okay. And this is for the silicon. So if you put the value of band gap of silicon here, you can find out the value of I 0. You can find out the value of I 0. You know the upper limit of I L for silicon. I told you already. What is the upper limit of I L for silicon? What is the upper limit of I L for silicon? 46 milliampere per centimeter square. Okay. So you put these numbers. You put these numbers, and you can actually find out what is the upper limit for open circuit voltage. Okay, so you can do this. What is upper limit for open circuit voltage for silicon? You do it in your free time. You will find that this value comes about. So these are the practical values, by the way. Okay, this values comes about about 750 millivolt, about 0.75. You can do this calculation on your own. Okay, so we have looked at the upper limit for current, we looked at the upper limit for voltage, and now upper limit for the fill factor. Fill factor is determined by the series losses in the solar cell, okay, resistive losses, series resistance and shunt resistance. But people have also shown that fill factor is also dependent on the open circuit voltage. So if you define a number called VOC divided by KT by Q, by the way, KT by Q has units of volt, okay. KT has a unit of electron volt, and if you divide by Q, KT by Q has the unit of volt. And you know that, all of you know that room temperature is the KT by Q is. So KT, I told you earlier, also has a unit of electron volt. KT by Q has a unit of volt, and at room temperature RT of 300 Kelvin, the value of KT is 0.0256 electron volt, or by KT by Q is 0.0256 volt. Okay, that is the value. You can normally use standard values in the calculations also. KT, K is a Boltzmann constant, T is a temperature, at 300 Kelvin, it is 25 milli electron volt. The KT or KT by Q is 25 millivolt. So here the kind of VOC divided by KT by Q, it is plotted in that way, and you can see that as the VOC increases, your fill factor also increases. As the VOC increases, your fill factor also increases. You can look at in the little bit clear, so the units and numbers become clear. If fill factor is a function of VOC, mainly it depends on the series resistance losses, but this is another relation. Fill factor is very much affected by the series resistance, and I will come back to that. Higher the series resistance of the solar cell, lower is the fill factor. So normally a lot of people actually work to design a solar cell with the low series resistance. Okay, fine. So this is how the upper limit of fill factor. Upper limit of fill factor, as we can as we discussed, the from the IV curve, upper value of fill factor. You know, normally if my curve should be square, right? My curve should be square. If my curve and so this is my ISC and this is my VOC as a solar cell, but in practice my curve is something like this, okay? And therefore this is my point. So the ratio of the two squares is what is the fill factor. So ideally you can have 100% fill factor if the curve becomes, but that will never occur. That will never occur. So your fill factor, we have seen VM IM divided by VOC ISC. Typically a highest value that you can go is about 85%, 86%, okay. So 85-86% is what fill factor you can get, this really, really, really high value. Ideally square IV curve means 100%, but you will never reach that. Okay. Fill factor is a function of series resistance of a solar cell, it is a function of shunt resistance of a solar cell, and it is also depends on the VOC that we have shown in the earlier cases. Fine. So highest limit of current, highest limit of voltage, highest limit of fill factor will give me highest limit of efficiency. So I told you that there has to be optimum value of the band gap, you know, it cannot be lower band gap, very low band gap, it cannot be very high band gap. First of all, look at this point very clearly. When we say efficiency, standard efficiency means many things, okay. When we say efficiency, first of all, we talk about spectrum air mass 1.5, okay. If your air spectrum is different, then your efficiency will be different, okay. When we talk about efficiency, we say either efficiency of single junction or multiple junction. So typically, standard practice is to give efficiency of a single junction solar cell. Also, when we give efficiency, we give efficiency with concentration or without concentration. As you concentrate more light in a solar cell, if time permits, I will show you that actually your efficiency increases. Okay. So therefore, when you are giving efficiency, and as a student of this course, you should never make a mistake. Okay. So efficiency is given for air mass 1.5 g spectrum, 1000 watt per meter square. Never get confused, okay. some people also give efficiency for some other spectrum. For example, concentrated solar cell, people use some air mass 1 spectrum, air mass 0 spectrum and something else. For all our applications, typically what people understand is the efficiency of air mass 1.5 g 1000 watt per meter square. As a course of a student of this course, never make a mistake. Okay. Efficiency of a single junction. When you say upper limit of a solar cell efficiency is 29%, I am referring to the upper limit of efficiency of a single junction. Okay, but when you go to multiple junction, or ideally when you go to infinite number of junctions, your solar cell efficiency can be 86%. Okay. We will discuss it later if time permits. But whenever mentioning the efficiency, I am mentioning single junction efficiency, or if it is specific, then I should say it is a multiple junction efficiency. And that is the different upper limit of the efficiency will be different for single junction, upper limit of efficiency will be different for the double junction, triple junction. And with without concentration, when I am making the efficiency without concentration of light, which means efficiency also depends on the light concentration. Okay. So, when you concentrate light, efficiency is increases, but normally all our practical purpose, when I am talking about silicon, I am talking about efficiency, air mass 1.5 g, 1000 watt per meter square, single junction without light concentration, of course, I am mentioning it at 25 degree centigrade. Some people go one step further and say, okay, what is the wind speed? So, wind speed, because wind speed also have a result of cooling. So, 1 meter per second wind speed approximately, this is the value. Okay. So, these are the parameter under which your single junction solar cell efficiencies are defined, never make mistakes. Single junction without concentration, air mass 1.5, 1000 watt per meter square, 25 degree centigrade. Cool. So, you have then the efficiency depends on the band gap, and you should not have very low band gap, you should not have very high band gap. Very low band gap means high short circuit current, but lower open circuit voltage. Very high band gap means high open circuit voltage, but lower short circuit current. So, somewhere there is optimum. Okay. Where is the optimum? Optimum value comes air mass 1.5 curve, we should look. Okay, this curve. Optimum comes about 1.45 electron volt. Okay. So, what is the optimum value of the band gap to get the highest efficiency? Air mass 1.5, I am sorry, band gap about 1.45 electron. And what is the value of highest efficiency? I am looking at the air mass 1.5 curve. Do not look at air mass 0 curve or black body curve here. So, this is the highest value almost, and this value comes to about 29%, as I said. Okay. So, the highest value of single junction solar cell is about 29%, that is possible. Where is your silicon? Silicon is not sitting at the highest value. So, the ideal, so what is the ideal band gap? So, ideal semiconductor band gap for solar cell is 1.45 electron volt. Is silicon is having ideal band gap? No. Then why silicon used? I already answered, there are many advantages that silicon provides. So, just here for the convenience, I am writing again, silicon has the band gap of 1.12 electron volt. Cadmium telluride has the band gap almost about 1.42 electron, very close to the ideal. Gallium arsenide has the band gap of 1.45 electron volt, very close to the ideal, almost ideal. Amorphous silicon has the band gap of 1.7 electron volt. CIGS has a band gap about 1 electron volt. So, these two materials are the best suited in as far as the band gap matching is concerned. Silicon is not suited, but silicon is still not bad. Look at the efficiency curve. Silicon is here very close to the maximum what you can get. People have demonstrated that with silicon, you all people have almost achieved 25% efficiency. Okay. So, upper limit of parameter is clear. Why the band gap, optimum band gap is 1.45 electron volt, should be clear to all of you now. So, let us move ahead, but we cannot actually, we do not reach to the ideal efficiency, particularly in the commercial scenario, because there are many losses that takes place in a solar cell. I have divided losses in two categories. One is called the fundamental losses that takes place, which nobody can help us. other is called technological losses. Okay. Fundamental losses, yes, we will discuss later. Fundamental loss is the loss of energy, which energy? Low energy photons. If your band gap is 1.45 ideal, all the photons which are having energy less than 1.45 electron will pass, will transmit, and therefore not contributing to the current, not contributing to the voltage. So, that is your loss. Losses of excess energy. So, if your band gap is 1.12 electron volt and if your photon is 1.2 electron volt, okay, or let me come to this, this losses I will come to. So, loss of voltage and loss of fill factor. Okay. Loss of fill factor, there is bound to have some series resistance you cannot help, and because you are going to make a metal contact, you are going to have some losses. So, the two most important losses, okay, if this is your band gap. Suppose I am talking about ideal band gap of 1.45 electron volt. Okay, this is 1.45 electron volt. What is my spectrum? Solar spectrum. What is the wavelength it contains? Are the energy it contains 3.5 electron volt to 0.3 electron volt. Okay, which means all the photons which are having energy 1.45 electron volt and lower than that will be lost. That is loss, transmission losses. Okay. So, those photons which electrically just pass by refers as a transmission loss. You know how much is the transmission loss? 23% of your incoming energy is just transmitting, passing by for the ideal band gap semiconductor, 1.45 electron volt, 23%. Okay. That is one loss. Now, suppose you have a photon which is 3.5 electron volt, which is falling. So, this will give actually give rise to electron. How much energy it will give rise? A 3.5 electron volt, right? Because all its energy it will give, right? But eventually, this extra energy, so what I need is only equal to the band gap energy, okay? Energy that I need is equal to the band gap energy only. Eventually, all the photons, so this excited electron will actually lose its energy, will come back here. So, your requirement is 1.45 electron, only you are supplying 3.5 electron volt. So, almost 2 electron volt of extra energy is getting wasted, it is not being utilized. So, your band gap is 1.45 electron, and any photon having energy higher than the band gap, any surplus of energy than the band gap energy is wasted in the form of heat. Okay. This loss is called thermalization loss. Thermalization loss. You know how much is this loss? 33%. Wow. 33% plus 23%. 33 plus 23 equal to 56%. Thermalization loss is 33%. Transmission loss is 23%. 56% of the incoming energy is getting lost. And what is the bad thing? That it is not in your control. You cannot do anything with it. This is fundamental loss. So, I tell my student that even if you pray a lot to the God, and you know, Lord Shiva gets happy and comes to you and say, okay, ask what you want. And if you say, okay, give me a solar cell of more than 44% efficiency, he will say, sorry, I cannot do that. Okay, so even Lord cannot help, because it is as per the law of physics. You cannot get, so 56% is your losses, what you can get is only 44%. So, only 44% of the incoming radiation is in your control, and again out of this you are going to get losses because of the metal contact. You have to have, your Fermi level is always lower than the valence band and conduction band, and therefore you are going to have losses. So, therefore, all after you, so this is the what is possible, and then you reduce the losses and you get about 29% ideal, right. So, that is how the number 29% comes. Getting it? So, lot of losses occurs which are not in our control. Is there any possibility by which I can avoid this losses, transmission and thermalization losses? Yes, there are possibilities by which you can avoid the transmission and thermalization loss. How you can do that? By making multiple junctions. By making multiple junctions, so 2 junctions, 3 junctions, 4 junctions, 5 junctions, infinite junctions. If you have infinite junctions, you will get 86% efficiency. But as far as the single junction is considered, 56% energy is just getting lost. Okay. So, what you see is this is the ideal what you can get. Okay. So, these are the losses, fundamental losses. Fundamental losses. But out of this, then you have to reduce the technological losses. What is technological losses? You want reflection to be 0, but can you achieve 0 reflection technologically? Very difficult. You can achieve, but very difficult. Okay, you want recombination to be 0, but can you achieve 0 recombination? You can achieve, but very difficult because your impurity levels are very high. Okay, you want series resistance of your solar cells to be 0, but can you achieve 0 series resistance? Very difficult, not possible. So, therefore, out of 29%, there are a lot of technological losses that occurs, okay, which is not which is very difficult to achieve. 0 resistance is very difficult to achieve, or low resistance is very difficult to achieve, low reflection is the, okay. So, when you minimize, when you reduce the technological losses, your solar cell as of today, that what people are making in industry is about 15% to 16% efficient on an average. And I am talking about crystalline silicon solar cell. 15% to 16% is the efficiency of the commercially available crystalline silicon solar cell you get. So, considering all these losses, you come here. Fine. Okay, so fine. Because I go into the explanation in the whiteboard, I actually lose track of time and I am not able to finish my slides which are designed. But anyway, I think it is important to give you the concept. Slides are always going to be with you. You can read more and more whenever you have time. So, there are fundamental losses which we cannot avoid. There are technological losses which is in our control, but very difficult because we have to also look at the commercial aspect, financial aspect of it. So, typically I divide losses in 3 categories. Optical losses, which occurs because, so this is how your junction looks like, right? Your N, the red is N, blue is P type, your metal contact, and then your back metal contact, rear metal contact. So, some of the light will either get absorbed in the metal contact or reflected, that is optical loss. Some of the light get transmitted, that is optical loss. Some of the light will get reflected from the front surface, that is optical loss. Recombination losses, where will the recombination occur? It will occur everywhere. It will occur at the rear side, it will occur in the bulk of the material, it will occur in the emitter. Remember, what is the emitter? N layer is referred as emitter, and this thick layer is P type is referred as a base, so base and emitter. PN junction is base and emitter. So, your recombination will occur at the metal contact, at the front surface, in the emitter, in the everywhere. Recombination occurs everywhere. And your resistive losses, your series resistance. Series resistance is the contribution of all the parts of the solar cell, and therefore, losses will occur there. And researchers and scientists always keep try to minimize the this kind of losses in all kind of solar cell. Okay. So, when you refer to the design of cadmium telluride, CIGS, copper, indium, gallium selenide, crystalline silicon, you minimize, try to minimize optical losses, recombination losses and resistive losses. The design of solar cell is all about, okay, in two terms you can actually summarize the design. The design of solar cell, the design of solar cell is all about two things. What are the two things? One, minimize recombination. Okay, and maximize absorption. Minimize recombination wherever it is happening, maximize absorption wherever possible. Okay, these are the two main mantras of solar cell design. Okay, everything is related to this, whatever we will discuss. So, minimize absorption, minimize recombination, maximize absorption. So, these are the just summary of the losses that I have discussed here, the losses optical and electrical, ohmic and recombination losses.